afternoon. Welcome. So nice to see real humans. So Steve and I are going to talk you through Privita's approach to modern data provisioning and, you know, give you a whistle-stop tour for how our approach to it can help customers, you know, access safe but high utility data for analytics. But before we get started, let's maybe describe what we mean when we say sensitive data. So that's me. If I had to describe myself, I would say that I'm an outdoorsy, plant-obsessed millennial, and in the lockdown I realized I have a lot of feelings, which is why I probably took to baking things with a lot of faces on them. I literally anthropomorphize everything. So that's a good description of who I am. But I can be obviously more easily and more efficiently identified by my personal data. So this is an example of personal data about me. What you can see is it's broken up into two categories. You can essentially group them into two categories. You have on the left direct identifiers. So these are the things that can allow you to uniquely identify me. And on the right, you have indirect identifiers. Now the thing about indirect identifiers is that you can't actually use them to identify me on their own, but in combination, you can. So if you just had my date of birth, you couldn't work out who I was. But you could combine that with my location, my job, my sex, and it's more likely that you'll be able to pick me out from a crowd. Now, it's important to make this distinction because what it essentially means is that you need to have different types of transformations in order to protect different types of data. Now, this is where Privita comes in, right? Our platform is essentially designed to support a wide variety of techniques so that you can find exactly the right transform you need to end up with the type of safe data you need for your analysis. We use four key concepts in order to help you do this. So we have a concept of schemas, which is essentially a description of data. We have policies that are at the heart of data governance, and they describe exactly the type of actions you need to take in order to make data safe to use. We have jobs, which basically is a concept we use to help you apply the transforms to your IT system, and we call these engines. And finally, PDDs, which are basically just containers that help you retain control over your protected data. So now on this side, you can see exactly how you would go about using Privita to make my data safe to use. So first, let's look at my direct identifiers, right? So my name here has been obfuscated or deleted. My email, passport number, and bank account details have been tokenized, and this type of transform protects it, but allows you to retain the format so that you can continue to use this data for different types of analysis. And now for my indirect identifiers, you can see the results of perturbation on my salary, right? And Steve, as you can see, I very aspirationally bumped my salary up by quite a bit. I've also used generalization to basically, on my date and on my, which is now a date range instead of my actual birth date. And I've also used it on my job title, which has been leveled up to a specific class. So once I've done this to all of the types of data that are deemed sensitive, you can basically mark it as safe for use in analysis. And should the eventuality of like a data leak arise, my data is going to be safe wherever it ends up. But as easy as I've made this look for just my data, achieving this at scale is a real big problem, right? It's no mean feat. And I guess you all recognize this. What it is basically a description of the type of data provisioning nightmare our customers tend to be mired in. So what you see here, just try and unpick it a little bit, is that you have, our customers have are faced with this massive, very obvious problem as they try to scale up their use of data. They are faced with an exponential growth in data that they need to stay on top of every day. They're also required to share this data with a large growing population of data consumers who want to analyze it for all of their tasks, and they want just-in-time access. And it is this demand for managing data at scale that makes it incredibly hard for leaders, managers, data owners to work out exactly what's going on in their organizations. And um, what ends up happening to the requests that come in is that they end up being tied up as people try to work out, you know, what they need to do. And in instances where they're forced to take shortcuts, they end up leading to, like, you know, problems and leaks, which essentially can bring about a lot of reputational harm to the business. And this is where Privitar comes in. And as I like to say, you know, basically to save the day. So Steve, do you want to talk us through what that looks like?
So, wow, a little bit loud. So good afternoon, everyone. My name's Steve Tobin. I'm going to talk you through a little bit of the platform. But just before I begin, can you stick your hand up if you have an NHS number? Okay. So the NHS uses us to DID the NHS numbers. So we're helping everyone. It's been particularly interesting during the pandemic to see how they use their data sets internally. But for us, we call this, you know, a little bit of an evolution. But what we're sort of building here is seen quite generally as a revolution. So we call this data provisioning. Next slide, please. So our company mission is to let you use 100% of your data safely and ethically across the boundaries of your company and beyond. Next slide, please. So this is the definition of modern data provisioning. So it's a combination of people, process, and technology to enable responsible usage of data. I've spent 20 years in this space. I started doing data warehousing. I got involved in the whole big data, data lake thing quite early on. I've seen some pretty scary use cases. But, you know, there's a creepy line that the Gartner analysts talk about, which is when you cross that creepy line, the use case gets very interesting. But the ability to use that data effectively is what drives business. You see everyone here talking about data, but you must use it responsibly. You must use it legally. You must use it ethically as well. And we combine best practices with technology to enable you to do that. So next slide, please. So there is this often considered sort of trade-off between utility and sort of privacy. So if you have a raw data set, it's very high utility. If you change it in some way and protect the privacy, it's often seen that you're compromising the utility in some way. We as a company are focused on allowing you to make, not have to make that trade-off. So allowing you to use very sensitive data, because what we have found is the most deep in or useful insights often comes from the most sensitive data. So it's a balance of the two. So there's a sort of maturity model around this. But next slide, please. We've seen that customers are looking for certain things. They're looking for safe data. They're looking for speed. And I don't just mean speed of, you know, processing the data. I mean speed of access. They want to get to it quickly. They're looking for scale, obviously. We grew up in customers like NHS and HSBC, which have just a little bit of data. They're looking for self-service. They're looking for business users to be able to come in and find that data. They're looking for all different shapes of data. I'd like to take credit for that, but that came from Ted Freeman at Gartner, so I have to give him credit for that piece. They're looking to run this on cloud or across clouds and on-premise, so often a hybrid environment, and they want full privacy and access across these things. And ultimately, as too many customers have said directly, they want self-service access to trusted data. People only want to search for data they can actually safely use. It's all very well having data catalogs and data governance tools, and I've built one or two in my time. If you can't actually use the data you find or get access to it quickly, then there's a lot of challenges around that. And, you know, having been in this industry a little while, we now see people talking about data ops and data mesh, but trusted data is at the foundation of all of that. If you're moving data through that is sensitive and not considering that, it can become a real issue. Next slide, please. So the company was founded in 2014. I was not around with the company at this point. I joined last September. But when they founded the company, they were really focused on privacy. Jason, the CEO, and the co-founders were kind of realizing that there was a real growing demand here. But we really focused on two users: the data owners, the people who own the data sets and want to share them, and then what we're calling the data guardians, the people who have to protect that data internally. This is often a legal and compliance team, a regulatory compliance team as well. And what we see is that today, The interactions between them is mainly done via email. It's very difficult to audit, very difficult to document. And when the regulator comes to you and says, what did you do to make this data safe? Searching through a whole bunch of emails to figure out why you gave data to someone is probably not the best way of doing it. So next slide, please. So again, we've got a great set of customers that have really helped drive us here. We've realized that it's actually not just about the guardians and the owners, it's also about the data users and consumers. And there are many tools today that provide a light level of access. There are data governance tools, there are data catalogs, but you don't just want to find data, you then want to provision it to them and deliver it to them so they can use it. So next slide, please. So we see these three key stakeholders all interacting. And the technology should facilitate this. It should allow collaboration, auditing. It should allow the data owners to be able to publish and share their data, the data guardians to protect it on the way through, and the data consumers to find and use it easily. Next slide, please. Just a little bit on the pain points. So if you're a data consumer, you want the right data at the right time, typically right now. You often struggle to locate that data. And if you then do find it, because somewhere someone's documented it in some sort of governance system, you then struggle to, how do I get it? It can often take weeks or months to get that data. If you're trying to drive your business, you found this great data set you think will be perfect, and it takes 3 months to get approvals to actually use it, that's not a good thing. And too many customers talk to us about this black market for data. This is how most companies function today. They have this internal black market where you could go in, find it. You have to go there because you have no choice. But when you take data from there, you know it's not necessarily legal and certainly not ethical for your use case. Data owners, they see data as an asset, not a liability. They want to share it, but then actually, once they start thinking about sharing it, they realize how scary it is. They want to publish it with the maximum utility, and they want to minimize their risk to them and to the business. They get a lot of individual requests from people saying, hey, I'd love to use this data set, or where can I find this data set? And they end up doing some governance work. And they're tempted by the black market, but they're also scared by it. And data guardians, these are a group inside your company that are incredibly important. They're often neglected. They get too many requests for, can I use this data for this purpose? The regulations are constantly changing. It's very repetitive work. They actually sort of feel like they're slowing down the business, and they know that oftentimes people won't come to them because they're afraid of the answer. So we've built a platform to allow you to combine all these users. Single platform, deeply integrated into the existing ecosystem, so it plugs into your favorite governance tools, your favorite catalogs, your favorite data integration tools, etc., all the way through. It also plugs into your favorite data marketplace. We're not we realize that data monetization is very important, but the data exchange is to focus internally. Inside that platform, you get data registration, what we call policies, the ability to create a policy that defines how that data will be used across your organization and beyond, a fully automated workflow layer, and then we've been doing this since 2014 in some of the most interesting environments you can imagine. So we've got a huge amount of expertise about how GDPR needs to be applied, what the California Privacy Regulation really means. So we package that up as what we call accelerators. So with that, I'm going to let Samira talk you through some of it.
Great. So now we're going to give you a little demo about a workflow that involves these stakeholders that Steve just talked to you about. I really hope it works, though. It's working? Yeah, brilliant. All right. So you'd start by setting up a connection, which is basically something that the data owner needs to do. So what you need to do here is set up a connection, and a connection is something that I, as a data owner, or somebody that's a technical owner, has to create in order to access their data sources. So you'd set it up, you'd name it, here's an S3 bucket, you'd tag it so that it had, you know, all of the right connection paths and access keys set up. Now what's really important about this, and something that separates Privitar from quite a lot of other players in the field, is we allow you to connect up to use data in a static consumption pattern, and also using, you know, a JDBC driver and proxy in a dynamic consumption pattern. So this is it's a really simple setup, and you know, you once you define the region and you hit next, you're kind of good to go. Great. So these are the other connection types available to you. Now the next thing you'd want to do, and now we're channeling the persona of the data guardian, you want to use the platform to define all of the business information that can be used downstream. So you want to start first by defining tags, and these are the type of things that you want to use when you're trying to look for data that's in an exchange or elsewhere. So you want to make sure you use good terminology that's identifying. You save it. Now let's do the same thing for data classes. So to create a new data class, all you need to do is to click on that button, you give it a label. I'm going to try and create a new data class for date of birth, because I'm finding that I'm coming across quite a lot of records that actually have a birth date in the field. So you set it up, you tag it, you make sure you assign the right kind of data class to it, and it's a really simple asset to create. Now let's talk about policies. So policies, basically, when you go into the policy section, you see all the transforms you already have access to. But let's try and create a new transform, right? So you pick from the different options available to you. Again, you pick regex, you describe it, I'm calling it a 7-character token. You define exactly what it needs to look like. And what you do now is you give it a title and description. You decide exactly what the transformation ID needs to do, and you click next. Now you also have transforms to play with, and you can see that there were two before, and now there's an extra one. Now let's try to create a policy, right? And the way that we look at things in this environment is that a policy is basically a sort of ordainer for rules, and rules are basically where everything happens. So when you create a policy, you want to title it so that it's descriptive. And here we're calling it research, which involves lots of individual data. You just press next, and it's created for you to use. Now let's try and add some transforms to it. So what we're doing now is we're creating a rule. Rules here are completely based on logic. And they're based essentially on two things. They're based on conditions, and they're also based on transforms. So once you've named your rule, you click next, and you go into the creation of a condition. So right now we have 4 conditions listed here, but at Pivotra we have about 20 that are driven by metadata. So let me talk you through an example, right? I'm going to say that for this specific rule, I want it to be based on a request date. So if a request comes in between, say, the 31st of July and the 31st of August, and the asset is tagged with research financial, then I want to assign all the following transforms to a data class. So if the data class is first name, then I want to use that 7-character token that I created before, rule I created before. And if I see a date of birth, then I always want to drop the field. So once you've set this up, and I hope you can appreciate how easy it is to do this, you just click complete, and you end up with a policy that you can use downstream for wherever it is that you see a use for it. Now let's go into the exchange and look at the data registration flow, because it involves new personas. So let's try to create a data set. And a data set here is just a product asset. It gives context to the data consumers to understand the assets, files, or tables that are relevant to a particular type of analysis, right? So once you create your data set, you want to try and add assets to it. You can do this by basically selecting a connection to the asset. And we've done this before, so you pick S3. You set a connection path to the file. And now you describe the asset again. Because remember, this asset has to be something that you can discover in a data exchange. So again, you title it sensibly so that people can search for it. The next thing you need to do is you tag it effectively. You review all of the details that can be used to access it. And what you do here is you start to describe the field. So this is where I, as a data owner, the one with who's most familiar with the file or table, curates the asset. And in this case, because we're using Exchange, the metadata can be imported from other places like governance tools as well. So this is where you would add a field, you would add class, you would review the different details, and then once that's done, you set the asset for approval. So So now with everything, with the request submitted, all you need to do is you would log in as a data owner and you would review the pending, you know, ACID registration request. It would give you a chance to review all the fields, it would give you a chance to review all the context, the purpose for which the request was submitted, and if everything looks right, then you basically just approve it, and the data becomes available to the data consumers who requested it. So that's a very, very simple run through of, you know, an end-to-end workflow, right from the request coming in and the governance, you know, workflow that needs to be in place to like approve it properly.
So we have spent the previous sort of, you know, 6 years building out about 20 core privacy capabilities. What we're really realizing, however, is that this end-to-end workflow is what really brings everything together. This is what ties it all through. Now, I know that you've probably seen a lot of data catalogs and others. What we actually do is we deliver the data. So we plug into those catalogs, but we can then provision the data out. But this one last thing. So most data tools today, so next slide please, their ability to track and monitor data ends at the boundary of where that tool exists. So what that means is if you provision a data set into your favorite reporting tool like Tableau or your favorite data science tool, like so the Data IQ guys just outside, if you want to deliver it into those tools, there is a potential that a user can then grab that data set out of that tool. Now, Privita built this about 2 years ago with our original release. We call this watermarking. So we've got a patented capability to insert into the data itself a hidden identifier per column. So what does that mean? Let's say your data scientist takes that data set, starts using it, and it ends up in an area of the internet you probably wouldn't want it to be in, a box somewhere. The first problem for you is that our data? There is no metadata associated with it. Someone's just dropped a file or a data source there. This is about 500 rows. With Privita, we can pick up that file, we can read through it. If it's over 500 rows, we can actually extract that watermark, and we can tell you exactly who it was given to, for what purpose, at what date, at what time. And it's per column. Hidden in each column, there is this identifier that's concealed inside there. We did the first version of this 2 years ago. V2 is just coming out now. It is deployable across both dynamic and what we call batch patterns. So that means if, say you have an on-premise data source and you're moving it to the cloud, we can encrypt and tokenize that data. If you drop the data set then, we can extract the watermark. If you then want to dynamically deploy that, so take that data set you've moved into the cloud and access it through your favorite reporting tool, like Tableau, Click, you know, any one of the vendors here, we can do the same thing there. So it's a combination of those two patterns. We're the only vendor to do both those patterns, but in addition, the watermarking is completely unique. So you can actually route data through your organization. This is not metadata. This is data. It's hidden inside the data set itself. So that means that if you deploy data into Snowflake, we can actually tell you where it came from. I spent 15 years of my life trying to tie together different metadata and other tools at the kind of governance layer. This means you could do it using the data itself. A very simple analogy. If you have a pet dog, how do you protect it if it runs off? You put a chip in it. That's exactly what you're able to do here. So it's just one last feature, but all of this is available across the platform. So we spent a good amount of time building this out. If you guys have any questions, I think we have a little bit of time for questions now, but were there any questions, actually? I don't know if we have a mic for you. Oh, we have it here, sorry.
Thank you. How do you or your clients manage deletion of data, so data requests for write to forget requests?
So we are very lucky in that in terms of write to be forgotten, we have a capability inside the platform today where when we sort of provision data out, the way we store the data internally means that we can actually tombstone the record so that if someone says to you, I want to be forgotten, we can actually make sure that it's never possible to get back to the original identifier. Yeah, it's a unique capability. Thank you for mentioning it. Any other questions? Okay, we have a booth just over the other side if you'd like more information. The company's been around. We're a startup, you know, originally started in London, but we now have grown across and started to invade the US. I'm a Brit slash American, so I have a funny Australian sounding accent, but we've been growing pretty quickly, as you might see. We started with some good core customers, but if you're interested, please do come and follow up with us. Thank you very, very much for your time today, and excellent job, Samara. Very good. Thank you for doing that.